Jadal has tried to cultivate momentum around the issue of affordable and accessible hostel with no curfew for past 3 years. We have tried to negotiate with admin through endless petitions, memorandums, letters and so on. At the same time, we have also asserted the fact that this space that the university is ours. Access to affordable and accessible accommodation is our right. Our night marches, our marches through different colleges highlight this factor really. That this space, which has kept us out for so long, especially in context of Stephens, which is so sexist and misogynist. And exactly the point that this is our right. And that they, if you don't give it to us, we will take it from you. So it's important for us to remember or take note about the history of resistance that has happened in Stephens. While I was studying in Stephens, we had union has actually organized principal trip, where it was a public interaction between students and the principal, where the curfew demand was raised over there. The principal actually proposed that the boys should also be like locked up rather than removing the curfew system.
We raised a couple of demands. One was that the doors of the individual hostels be left unlocked and the main doors of the campus should be locked up. And that night outs should be increased in number. We should be able to get night outs without having to furnish reasons or calling our parents, things like that. So these demands were raised in a UGB.
It was like almost like 500 students coming for the general body meeting with the principal.
And the general expectation was that some of the more radical ones might not be accepted, but the smaller demands would be well taken. But the principal responded so virulently.
And then he said, you know, and then it became, but the general body meeting was quite a disappointment because he started, you know, talking and he wouldn't let anybody else talk. And then he got the door shut and he said, you called this meeting and you want us to be in this meeting, so I'm not going to open the doors until I'm done talking. And he said some terrible things like girls and boys are very different, you know, they're like eggs and stones and apples and oranges, and you know, would you like, if you're in an airplane, would you like really keep the door open, you know, like, you know, how can you keep the girls hostels doors open? Everybody was very angry and they were like, we want to sit out, and we just won't go back to the hostel after 10, you know, we'll just sit out on the lawns and we won't go inside. Except that didn't happen because we were all really scared that we'd be thrown out, and it seemed like a very big thing that at that point that they could come down on us.
So it was very insulting, like the whole thing was pretty insulting. The fact that so many people got chucked out was the main dampening effect, because you know, like people got really scared.
This outing of women students from the hostels is also particularly gendered, because if you think about instances where, say, the male students have broken the rules, they have always gotten off with the mere suspension or a fine, while for women students it's immediate expulsion.
That threat is very real when it comes to participating in any kind of protest against the administration, or even like questioning the authorities when it, like, restrictive practices by the administration. And it's important that we realize that this is the time that it's important that we remember the kind of the history of resistance in St. Stephen's College, where women have collectivized and raised their voice despite administrative repression against these patriarchal rules.
This interview system only came to place in Stephen's after 2013 because of the house arrest movement that happened in that year, which was basically protests against the curfew. So the fact of the matter is that one has to completely remove this interview system so that people do not perpetually live in fear that presidents will be taken away from them.
I want an explanation, sir. You threaten with suspension and expulsion. You call us guests. You tell us we are not equals. We say we are. We say we belong here. We say your threats will not change our beliefs. We are sure of what we believe. We know we are equal. We know the college is ours. We know why you are here, sir. Not for tradition, not for privilege, but for us. We know all this, and we also know, sir, that this college hurts its students. A college conceived for students, and amidst all this knowing, this surety, this refusal to stop talking, to stop using words which you fear, sir, and counter with threats. Amidst this conviction, I cannot understand. So explain to me, why do you hate freedom? And why do you fear those who ask for it?
The fact is that if women students need accommodation, every student should get accommodation. If the college doesn't have enough resources, they should appeal to the central university to make hostel allocations a centralized process.
So remember, there were lots of discussions about the need for a third women's block inside campus. At that time, there were only two, Allnut South and Rudra South, while for men, there were four. The administration was sort of dragging its feet, and you know, often the claims of St. Stephen's College of being a so-called premier institution would be cited to talk down the demand for a third women's block. But at the heart of it was, of course, a very deep-seated discriminatory attitude prevalent in the administration as well as among students. There were some people who would talk of the admission of women in college itself as a mistake.
The people of Anga,
the people of Anga,
have solemnly resolved,
have solemnly resolved,
to constitute Anga,
to constitute Anga,
into a paramount,
into a paramount,
egalitarian fellowship,
egalitarian fellowship,
and to promote,
and to promote,
among them all misogyny,
among them all misogyny.
So the context of the oath is that the reason that it started being said in college is because girls were being admitted into college for the first time in the 1970s or the 1960s. And that year, on Valentine's Day, all the boys of Anga came together to say the oath, to reaffirm their resolve that regardless of the fact that girls have joined the college, they will never really be part of the college in the way that we are. We don't think it's okay for this dominant group of men to go ahead and pledge to promote misogyny by giving a disclaimer by saying that this is a joke, right?
I have seen horrible shit go down in this college. I just want to say, I'm so tired of this space. I'm so tired of the misogyny in this space.
Is this tradition? This is not tradition. This is blatant misogyny. People are promoting this and the college administration is in on it.
Shame!
And another thing that one also has to talk about is the fact that we broke through the Allnut Gate, which sort of is the gate and the lodge, it sort of is the epitome of eliteness that the college represents. This pristinity that this gate holds, that this gate will be only open for the principal, for one of the old boys, or the so-called celebrities like Subramanian Swami. These things should be challenged and should be critically engaged with. This is also the reason why when the autonomy protests were going on, that one occupied the Allnut lawns, which is to show our resistance against these arbitrary elitist rules that the college just comes up with.
Also in context of, say, like liberalization and privatization coming in, one has to also talk about how guards of our college are also like targeted. Since they are also on contractual basis, they have been easily pitched against the students, which is also like a very administrative trick that is being used by various administration at different places. So for asserting our demands of affordable and accessible hostel facility, do join us for the protest on 30th in large numbers.